Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day on the beach here in Hawaii, and we just thank you for each person that's here. Lord, I love the way that you can use Pastor Izzy to speak to each one of us. And whatever trials, whatever problems or celebrations we're in life right now, Lord, you can encourage us. So we ask you to do that now. Help us to keep our eyes fixed on you. Keep our minds from getting distracted from other things. And Lord, let us just trust you with our life. We ask that now in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, guys, would you begin this morning by turning to Matthew chapter 21. Today is the message about Palm Sunday. Now, how many of you have heard the story of Palm Sunday? Jesus riding into Jerusalem on what? What did he ride? A stallion, right? No, not a stallion. A donkey we're going to see this morning. In fact, a baby donkey. And if you have the King James, an ass. That's right. When I read that out of the Bible that, you know, hey, Mom, they use the word ass in the Bible. Can I use that? She said, not the way you want to. And but, you know, it is actual name of a donkey or jackass. For those of you that have been raised around farms, you know that's why they call them that. In fact, that's why they might call you that if you were stubborn and, you know. By the way, are donkeys known for having a great disposition? No. And today I want to show you this story, what is a fulfillment of a prophecy given by Zechariah. In Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, there is a prophetic word given about the Messiah that says he's going to come. One of the signs that they would know it's truly the Messiah is that he was going to come humbly riding on a colt of an ass, a baby donkey. He's going to come riding in to Jerusalem to bring this salvation. Now, today we sang, Hosanna, Hosanna. That's going to be from our text this morning, as you're going to see the people, when Jesus does come riding in on this baby donkey, they're going to cry out, Hosanna. But what does Hosanna mean in Hebrew? Anyone know? Save now. Save now. Now, was Jesus coming to save now when he came to this earth the first time? He was. But I want you to know, if you have any Jewish friends, they didn't look at it like save us from our sins now. Because in some rabbis, even to this day, teach that the Old Testament prophesies of well, they call it two messiahs. One that will save from sin, and one that would save from oppression and from the you know, wicked rule. And the latter one, by the way, is the one that most Jews are, that's the one they want. They're rallying for, we want the guy who's going to save us. You know, if you look back 2,000 years ago, who was ruling the world in the Jerusalem area? What government had control? Rome. Were they known for being greatly and kind and just benevolent to all of their subjects? No. And so Rome was ruling at this time when Jesus came to this earth, and the people were oppressed. And the teachings of the prophets that said God is going to send a savior. Well, the ones like in Isaiah 52 and 53 that talk about how he's going to save from our sin and by his stripes we would be healed and all that stuff. They're like, that's great and all, but we need the guy who's going to come riding in with you know, power and his army and slay all the wicked and establish a kingdom of righteousness and no more persecution. And we want that guy. Now, by the way, does the Bible teach about both of those fellas? Are there prophecies that talk about this triumphant Savior that will come with his armies? And in fact, we read about him in Revelation, don't we? On this white horse that flies. He'll come in with myriads and myriads, thousands and thousands, thousands. In the Hebrew, that's how they get their biggest number. You go, ten thousands of ten thousands. That's like saying millions and millions. That's the highest number they have in Hebrews, 10,000. So that 10,000s of 10,000. 10,000 of 10,000s of 10,000s is like saying millions and millions. all of the saints will come flying. Now, the Jews believe that that will happen. But they didn't really like the part about he's going to come to save from the sin right then. Because if they had a choice, they'd be like, let that guy come later. Just get us out of the oppression. We want to be freed from oppression. So today, I want to show you through the Gospels. Now, I'm going to take a little survey through the Scripture today, and I'm going to start in Matthew's Gospel, and to show you something, if something is repeated in the Gospels, like it's in Matthew and Mark and, say, Luke, is it important that it gets three highlights? You know, or maybe it's in two of the Gospels, Mark and John or whatever. If it's repeated, for me, anything that is repeated, it's not because God is a broken record and he's like run out of material. There's a reason. This must be something really important. And to let you know, just to emphasize how important this story is of Jesus coming on the donkey, this is recorded in how many Gospels? You got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Who knows? Anyone know? All four. All four Gospels tell this account. Okay, told by four different people. Now, this is one of the things I love. Some people say, oh, there's contradictions in the Bible. One gospel tells it like this, and another gospel tells it like this. And I said, that's not a contradiction. That's a compliment to the story. It's getting it from a different angle, a different point of view. But it's not at all conflicting. It's just giving me a better picture of that day. You know, of the goings-on, I get it from one person's perspective that was maybe over there, and then from another person's perspective that was over there. And if I just read all the accounts, it paints in this beautiful picture. It gives me like I was there that day, but I wasn't just in one spot. I was there here, and I got to hear it from over here, and I got to see him from over there. And today I want to show you this story from the perspective of just two of the fellas. Okay, I can't pick all of the perspectives and do it in one short sermon, but I'm going to do my best just to show you it from two fellows' perspective. And the two fellows I'm talking about are the two that are going to be assigned the task of going and getting the baby donkey. Okay, we're gonna look at. I want you to just do me a favor. We're gonna read just some highlight survey through all four of the Gospels, but with the eyes of looking at it, what if you were one? Anyone here would volunteer to go get the donkey for Jesus? If he said, you know, hey, I need the donkey, you know, to fulfill Zechariah. He didn't even tell him why. He just says, I need you to go get the donkey. Let me read it to you. Turn to Matthew 21. We'll start there, and we're going to just go quickly from Matthew to Mark to Luke to John, where we'll conclude today. So let me show you this. In Matthew 21, it says, verse 1. When they had approached Jerusalem, it says, and come to Bethpage, at the Mount of Olives, it says, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied there, a colt, with her, and untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says to you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them, and immediately they will send them. So this took place to fulfill, it says, what was spoken through the prophet, say to the daughter of Zion, your king, behold, your king is coming to you, gentle and mounted on a donkey, even a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. This is the quote of Zechariah 9:9. It says, and the disciples went and did just as Jesus had instructed them. And they brought the donkey and the colt, they laid their coats on them, and they sat, it says, and he sat on the coats. And most of the crowd spread out their coats in the road. And they cut branches from the trees, and they spread them in the road. And the crowds were going ahead of him. And those who followed, they were shouting, Hosanna! Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest! Save now! Now, by the way, this word Hosanna doesn't just mean save now. This is, it has a connotation built into it. It is a cry for salvation, save us now, but it's a cry like you would cry to an authority figure, to somebody who had power. You wouldn't say Hosanna to somebody who didn't have power to save. It would, like, you know, you don't cry out to kindergartners, Hosanna, Hosanna, you know. and you want them to save you. This is not going to work, okay? This isn't a cry out to the general public or the laity. This is a cry to, it actually has a built-in significance. It's a cry to somebody who has power, they're in authority, a king, a ruler. That's who you have to use this word with, Hosanna. And so they're crying out, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And when he had entered Jerusalem, it says the city was stirred. And they said, who is this? And the crowds were saying, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. So here, then Jesus, it says, he entered the temple and he drove out all who were buying and selling in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those that were selling the doves. And he said to them, it is written, my house shall be called a house of what? Of prayer. And you are making it a den of robbers. Okay? And then the blind, I just had to point this out. And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple. And what did he do? You guys already know what's Jesus going to do. Someone got a problem. He's going to heal. So Jesus healed them. Now, the reason I'm pointing this out is because this is a different little nugget that is pointed out by Matthew. That in the other accounts, they don't point out that Jesus had the blind and the lame coming and Jesus healing them. But one thing they do have in common is that they all mention this thing of Jesus going into the temple and chasing out these guys that were making merchandise. On this day, it's very interesting to me, Jesus is fulfilling a great prophetic word about the coming Messiah. And on the day that he fulfills it, when he takes this little baby donkey ride, he's going to ride up to the temple and he's going to go into the temple and be used to cleanse the temple. Now, let me show you. Go to Mark's gospel. This same sister passage is shared with us in Mark chapter 12. No, I'm sorry, Mark 11. Mark 11. It says, it reads really similar, except for a few details. Let me show you what Mark points out. It says, as they approached Jerusalem at Bethpage, this is Mark 11, verse 1. It says, and they approached Bethany near the Mount of Olives. He sent two of his disciples, said to them, go into the village opposite you. And immediately as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. Now, this is one of the things different in Mark's gospel than in Matthew's. Mark points out that how are they going to find the donkey in the village? How would they know where it is? By the way, did Jesus know where the donkey was? I want to point some things out to you. The difference of perspective. Did these guys know what was going on versus did he know what was going on? Because today is a great day to point this truth out. Is that does the Lord know all things? Does he know everything, where our provisions are, where the things are, what we're going to need for life? Does he know? Yes. Did they? No. But to make sure that they would know where the donkey was, Jesus says, go into the village opposite us, right over there. And by the way, I've been to Jerusalem, and I asked the tour guides, where is, Bethpage, Bethany, where we're standing, the Mount of Olives right there, where is the village opposite? And he goes, right there on that hill. And there's just, they call them mountains, but I call them, like hills, okay, with little washes in between. They call them valleys. Like, valley, like, it's nothing, man. I could jog across that. It's like a little dip, But when he says, go across to the village opposite, right over there. And Jesus, listen to this. Jesus says, you go in and immediately as you enter it, you will find the colt tied there. So, in other words, you don't have to go wandering all around the village to find the mama donkey with its baby. You will find it right as you enter. Right there. Go in and there. Just look. Now, he doesn't say right side or left side, but he just says right there. Donkey, not too hard to find, probably, as soon as you enter. They go in, it says, and I like this, verse 3. Now, we don't know who the two fellows that got assigned the task. Was it Peter and James or John? Or, it seemed like those guys were the inner circle, probably. I suspect Peter was one of them. No, it's just a I can't prove it. I just think because I know the Gospel of Mark was Mark, where did he get his information from? From Peter. And so when you read the Gospel of Mark, there's like these little subtle things that speak about things that Peter knew. And they're like real personal little things that none of the other gospel writers write. Look at this account and tell me if you think maybe Peter might have been one of the two. It says, then they were told, if Jesus said, if anyone, verse 3, says to you, why are you doing this? Then you will say, the Lord has need of it. And immediately he will send it back here. And they went away and they found the colt tied at the door, it says, outside the street. And they untied it. But some bystanders were saying to them, what are you doing untying? By the way, if you're untying a donkey from someone's place and starting to lead it away, do you understand that in their culture, this is like grand theft larceny? I mean, this is stealing. But this is like stealing, you know. I mean, in the desert, they got the camel for desert travel, all-terrain vehicle. Your ATV, and you got a donkey, which is like it's your pack mule. It's your Jeep. You load up the stuff with the truck. It's a pickup truck of the day. I mean, you're stealing somebody's truck. Can you imagine going up to someone's place and you're sent of the Lord? The Lord says, go get me that truck. I need that truck. And when you go and get, it's going to be right when you get into the town, right there, as soon as you come in. And just go ahead and jump in, take the keys, and start her up and bring it back. And if anyone stops you and says, what are you doing taking that truck? You just tell them the Lord has need of it. And they'll say, okay, go ahead, take it. Now, I'm only putting it in this, you know, it happens in Kona. Yeah, some guys think they just help themselves to somebody's truck, but not because the Lord directed them to. This is the interesting part. This account tells us that the two of them went and they were stopped. Matthew didn't point this out. So I know just from the Gospel of Matthew, this extra little detail, that the two guys that were sent on the job, they actually did get stopped as they were untying the colt. And they actually had, and I want to know, okay, now if you were one of the two, let's say it's Greg, you and me, we're going to go get the donkey, okay? On the way, while we're talking about who's going to untie it, you untie it. No, you untie it, is. No, you, Greg, you untie it. No, you untie it. I ain't untying it. I mean, look, you untie it, I'll tell him the Lord has need of it. Let's do that. Right? I mean, which assignment would you volunteer for? You're going, neither one. I don't want to do it, man. I wonder what was going through their minds as they're going to the village going, the Lord said, go get the baby donkey. No one's ever sat on it. This is a little kooky, you know. What happens when we start to untie it? You're going to untie it, right? And when we get there and they untie it, and it says right here, and they said, what? Stop. What are you doing? Now, Matthew just said, and they came back with the donkey. The reason I think Peter might have been one of the guys is because this little detail is recorded here. Somebody on the inside who went to get the donkey knows the part of the story that when they were taking the donkey, when they were untying it, they actually got stopped. And by the way, in the Middle East, if you're taking someone's donkey, what do they have the right to do to you for thievery? I mean, what's their custom? They'll either cut off body parts, or they'll cut right here and end your life. I mean, depending on the severity of what they feel you've done is wrong, you can lose your life for this kind of theft. And Mark tells us they did it. They stopped them. What are you doing? And I don't know if they both chimed in. The Lord has need of it. I mean, come on. How confident do you think they were at this point? As they're stealing the, I mean, they in their culture, that's stealing. The Lord has need of it. And listen, Mark tells us that as soon as they spoke this, it says they gave them permission. Okay, go ahead. Now, can you imagine walking back with the donkeys? Come on, let's go. Could you believe it? It worked. Come on, let's get out of here before they change their mind. I mean, what would you be thinking as you're all the way walking back across the wash, back up to the other hill, bringing the donkey to Jesus? You get going, and you're bringing this donkey to the Lord, and going, wow, it worked. We just stole a truck, and all we did was say, the Lord has need. Now, don't be stealing trucks today and saying the Lord has need of it. Use that as your excuse. This is just to show the power of our God. When it comes to Him knowing what we need, where that thing is that we need, how to get that resource to us, even to do something that, to my natural mind, this is crazy. I mean, being raised Sicilian, you don't steal like this and then just say, oh, God said I have need of it. And they let you go. Like, that doesn't work. So this is really, to me, a remarkable point that Mark is pointing out to us. Now it says, they brought the colt to Jesus. They put their coats on it, Mark 11 says in verse 7. And verse 8 says, and then many spread out their coats in the road, and they spread out leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. And those went in front of those, it says, and there were those that followed, and they were all shouting. I want you, just little Mark here, because Matthew didn't point this out. They are not just saying Hosanna. They are shouting Hosanna. There's a group in front shouting Hosanna, putting down branches. There's a group in back. Just keep this in mind. Highlight, shouting. Okay? I'll tell you why I think this is remarkable, too, in just a minute. And they cried, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. That's, by the way, Psalm 118, verse 26. It's just a quote. They're a fulfillment here. And that, by the way, that psalm is a prophetic psalm. It says the Messiah would come, and they would cry. So this is really significant. They're crying out, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest. Here they are crying this out, and Jesus enters the temple, came into the temple, looking around at everything. It says he was there with, it says, and then he left for Bethany. And if you read on, it says, and then he came to the temple, and he drove out the money changers, told them, this is my father's house. It's a house of what? Of prayer. Same thing included. Just a little, and then there was the one with the withered hand, and of course he fixed that, and you know Jesus, showing off. Little things. Let me show you something from, now just remember, this one told us the two fellows did get stopped. Let me show you something from Luke's gospel. And this account in Mark's gospel tells us that the crowd was throwing down the branches. That's what we celebrate Palm Sunday, is that they're putting down the palm leaves. But this little detail is recorded not in just one gospel, but two. In Luke chapter 19, same sister passage, it says, when they approached Bethany, verse 29, Luke 19:29, they came near the mount called Olivet, and he sent two of his disciples, saying, go into the village ahead of you. As you enter, you'll find a colt tied there on which no one has ever sat. Bring it here to me. Okay, let me just make sure we got this detail. How many people ridden this donkey? Nobody. Has anybody here ever been on a farm and had the privilege of, let me roll my eyes really a lot, the privilege of breaking a donkey on which no one has ever sat? By the way, how akin are these little critters to having something put on their back? If they've never had a pack load on them, they do not come housebroken. They do not come pack broken. They do not come ready to ride, okay? And I have to point this out. Right here, Jesus said, go get the donkey, which no, listen, Jesus, couldn't you have said, get the donkey that everyone has ridden? It'll make a great ride into, no. Because Zechariah said he would come humble on this colt of a foal on which no one, this is really important, no one has ever sat. You say, why is that important to the story? I'm going to show you. It says here, and if anyone asks you, why are you untying the donkey? Verse 31, you say to him, the Lord has need of it. So those were sent away and found it just as he told them. And as they were untying the colt, the owner said to them, what are you doing untying that colt? They said, the Lord has need of it. And they brought it to Jesus, and they threw their coats on the colt. Pay attention. Mark said the same thing. They put the coats on the colt. There was other people putting their coats on the ground with the branches. It's not just branches they threw down. They should have made Palm Sunday coats and palm branches. And that didn't sound as good. You know, Coat Sunday. No, because they were throwing their coats down too, weren't they? In front of him. This was by the way, if you threw your coat down for a little donkey to step on, I mean, what were you saying about the person on the donkey? He's worthy of something. I mean, you're giving acknowledgement that you're willing to take your own coat and throw it down to pave the way. I mean, remember, they had dirt streets back then. For them to throw their coat down, you know, this is where chivalry comes in, you know. But in this case, it's not chivalry like a guy laying it down over the puddle for the gal to get across. This is a mark of respect saying, this is a king. And I'm willing to take my very coat and lay it out so that he gets, like we'd say, the royal, red carpet treatment, you know? Only it was their very coats they were putting down on the ground. The branch, they were saying, this is a king coming. A king. But he's riding a ride that nobody's ever taken for a ride. And they're putting coats on the back of it. And he, it says, was going, and as he was, they were spreading the coats in the road. And as soon as he was approaching, verse 37, near the descent of the Mount of Olives, going down that descent, the whole crowds of the disciples began to praise God, it says, joyfully, with a loud voice, for all the miracles which they had seen. And they were shouting. It wasn't, Hosanna, Hosanna. They were shouting, Hosanna, save now. They're crying out. And it says, blessed is he, the king, who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven, glory to the highest. And some of the Pharisees of the crowd, they said to him, teacher, rebuke your disciples. Tell them to quit crying this out. And Jesus said to them, I tell you truly, if these were to become silent, the very stones would cry out. Now, if you've never been to Israel, do they have stones there? I mean, we have a lot of rocks on the Big Island. Ours are dark. They have these, like, kind of golden-colored rocks. In fact, they have a law that if you build in the old Jerusalem, you have to actually face the outer walls of your building with what they call Jerusalem stone. Today they take the stones and they send them to mills and they mill them into like to where you see just the outer part, and they make a veneer, and they sheet the whole side of the building with this stone. It's a requirement in the old city. And those stones, they have this golden hue, especially during the sunrise and sunset time, that just the color of the rock just makes it look like a city of gold. And Jesus says, there's stones everywhere in Jerusalem. He says, if these people were to become quiet, these stones would cry out. That's why I always make the joke, that would be a real rock concert, wouldn't it? It wouldn't be the Rolling Stones, it'd be the Crying Stones. But they'd be, you know, crying out, Hosanna, can you just see the rocks crying? Would the rocks really cry out, you think? If they would have been quiet. Jesus says, I tell you the truth, if they were to be silent, these very stones would cry out. Because this day, what we're studying about, this is a very significant day. This was the coming of Jesus to this world saying, here I am, I've come to save. But not like they're thinking save us from oppression of the government. He's going to save them from oppression of sin. That sin and the work what Satan had done to bind these people in bonds, he's going to set them free from that. So it says in verse 41 of Luke 19, when he approached Jerusalem, he saw the city and he wept over it. Now, the other guys don't tell us this. just Luke. Luke says when he saw the city, he started weeping. And he spoke these words. He said, "If you had known this day, even you, the things which make for peace, but now it's been hidden from your eyes. For the days will come upon you when your enemy will throw up a barricade against you and surround you and hem you in on every side. And they will level you to the ground and your children within you. And they will not leave it you with one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation." And then it says, he entered the temple. You guys know the whole rest of it. Drives out the guys, says, "This is my Father's house." It's a house of what? Of prayer. Now, each one of the gospel accounts throw this part in. Must be important. I don't know why, but I don't remember too many Palm Sunday messages where they mention this part. It's like they stop before they get to the part that's, I think, pretty important. You know, why would Jesus go in and say, get rid of this money changers and this merchandising going on? You know, this is my Father's house. This is supposed to be a house of prayer. What would Jesus do today if he came into some of the American churches? I mean, you get in the foyer, right? There's the bookstore with all of the latest Christian T-shirts. And I call it Jesus junk. All the, you know, you got a Jesus cup, a Jesus pen, a Jesus. Anything you can slap Jesus' name on, marketers have done so. And where are they selling most of that Jesus junk? In the foyer of a church. In America. Not globally. I'm just talking about American Christianity. And face it, we got to own up to it. We do it. And you come into the foyer. I wonder what Jesus would do if he came in, you know, like, just a visit. Stop by, donkey ride. Just rides over to the American church. "Hey, guys, whoa. What's this stuff?" What do you think he would do? I think he'd throw it out. I think he'd be like, "Wait a minute. What does this have to do with people's desire to seek God? You've taken the desire of people to draw near to God and taken it as an opportunity to make fortune. That's not what it's about." Jesus got really upset. I don't know if you realize this, but let me just show you. In John's gospel, one little extra detail. Last one here, John chapter 12. Got to wrap this up. Jesus, therefore, it says in John chapter 12, go to John 12, verse 9. It says, there was a loud, that was Luke's gospel. There was a large crowd, it says, of the Jews that had learned that Jesus was there. And they came not just for Jesus' sake only. Now here's something that none of the other guys pointed out. How big was the crowd? Large. And why were they all there? Well, only John mentions this, that they were there not for only for Jesus' sake, but they wanted to see someone else. Do you see who it is? They want to see Lazarus, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Now, you might not think about this, but if you had a fellow that had been dead for 4 days, buried in the grave, closed up, and Jesus came into the, remember Mary and Martha? "If you had just been here, Lord, my brother wouldn't have died." See, they believed Jesus could heal sickness, but they didn't understand something even more important. Jesus doesn't just do sickness. I've told you this before, right? Jesus does dead. He can fix dead. Dead is not like beyond his scope of ability, but they didn't know that. In fact, Jesus said, "It is for your sake that I was not here." So your faith would be increased. And when they get to the tomb, Jesus says, "Roll away the stone." And specifically, he says, "Lazarus," they're in a graveyard, by the way. If he would have just yelled, "Come forth," they would have all the graves would have opened up. But Jesus said, "Lazarus, come forth." And Lazarus, it said, came hopping out. He was already wrapped for burial. He's in the burial cloth. He comes wrapped, like, and Jesus says, "Unbind him." And what else does he say? And give him what? Give him something to eat. He's been dead. Not mostly dead, dead. Those of you who know Princess Bride know what I'm alluding to. He's dead. for 4 days. Now, it says there was a large crowd there at this occasion, not just to see Jesus. They wanted to see somebody whom Jesus had resurrected. Think about it. For you journalists in the crowd, you'd probably be going, let me in first. I got to do the interview. So tell us, was there a light? Was there a tunnel? Was there a, what does God look like? What was it like? I mean, first of all, if there was someone who had been dead 4 days and Jesus brought him back to life, would anyone besides me want to talk with that person? Come on, let's be honest. Raise your hand if you would want to. But come on, for real, we would go and say, come on, tell us. And Lazarus was there. The bummer comes next. I can believe, but it saddens me to think what John tells, the next detail he tells in this gospel account, is that the people wanted to see Jesus and Lazarus, but the chief priests, the guys Jesus has already ticked off by throwing out of the temple, right? You know, of the merchandising going on. Jesus is not so popular with them. The chief priests, it says, they have planned also to put who to death? No, we know they were planning to kill Jesus, right? But if you didn't read John's gospel, you wouldn't know this little detail. They were also planning on killing Lazarus. Again. No, I mean, because on account of him, it says, many of the Jews were going away and believing in this Jesus. Man, there's a stirring. The people are excited, shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna. The religious leaders are telling them, tell them to shut up. And Jesus says, if I do, there'll be a rock concert. They'll cry out, Hosanna. This day has to happen. And he's telling them these things, and they're going, man, we're going to kill this guy, and we're going to kill that other guy who's already dead, but we're going to kill him again, make him dead again. Can you imagine me and Lazarus? I'd be like, man, I already did this. But if he doesn't want me dead, he'll just say, get back up. You know, come back. Right? I mean, that's all Jesus did was say, come forth, Lazarus. And he came back from the dead. How many believe Jesus really did that, by the way? Yeah? See, he has the power over death and life. He can take dead and resurrect it to life. Lazarus, ironically, this part isn't in the gospel. When we get to heaven, I'm going to ask him. So Lazarus, when they were going, we want to kill him too. How'd you feel about that? I mean, from a guy who had already crossed over and come back, you know, he might not be doing what you're thinking. He might have been saying, good, take me out, man. It was way better over there. You know, seriously, think about it. If you had been to heaven and then put back in your earthly body and be like, I remember Chuck Smith. How many of you heard of Pastor Chuck? He started the Calvary Chapels. He says, listen, I know some of you are really on fire for the Lord and just excited to operate in any of the gifts of the Spirit, whatever God wants you to do, and you pray for the sick. You'll go to the hospital and pray for the hurting there, you know. You'll go to the person on the side of the road and pray for them. And he says, and I know that should someday the Lord be kind and you know, some glad morning when this life is over, what's going to happen, the psalm says? Suddenly I'll fly away. He says, so if the Lord should take me, I'm preaching to you and I fall down, I have a heart attack, whatever, and I fall down here and I go to be with the Lord, and one of you young whippersnappers comes up and lays hands on me and prays over me that I come back. You know, Lazarus maneuver. He said, the first thing I'm going to do when I wake up, I'm going to knuckle print you. And he was serious. I never seen Chuck look like seriously mad, but I could tell the sincerity of this. Don't you dare pray for me once I'm dead. Leave me. I'm there, you know. I never thought about it. Like, it made heaven really real when he said that. You know, I mean, I believed heaven was real, but here was a man who was looking forward to going to heaven with such a fire. Like, man, don't you even pray me back here. I already did my time. Done. You know, don't need more down here. Lazarus, when he heard that they were, the religious leaders wanted to kill him, he's probably going, fine. man, I'm going back to paradise. Do it. Make my day. You know? I mean, first time I read it, I thought the other way, because I was thinking, oh, wow, cool, you're back. You know, Mary and Martha, they were really bummed out. You guys know the story. They were crying, Jesus, why weren't you here? If you were just here, my brother wouldn't have died. And Jesus said, any man who believes in me, even if he does die, he shall not die. But he'll have everlasting what? Life. He asked the girls, do you believe this? They're like, well, yeah, but our brother's still dead and we're sad. I mean, you read the account yourself there about Mary and Martha. Oh, you have to find it, just back up a couple pages from where we're at right here in John's Gospel. You'll see the account of Mary and Martha when Jesus healed them and healed Lazarus and raised him. But because Jesus did this resurrection, there was crowds gathering, large crowds. Now, the reason I'm pointing this out is large crowds putting garments on the donkey, putting garments on the road, putting branches in the road, and what were they doing with their voices? Shouting. And Jesus is about to get on a donkey that no one has ever ridden. I don't know about you, but I've been on a farm where we break horses, and you do not try to break horses with a rodeo going on around you. You do not try to break horses when there's a lot of noise or gunshots or it's hunting season. You break horses when it's quiet, in the calm of the morning, when there's just that gentle breeze blowing through the meadow and the birds singing lightly and everything's calm. In fact, the more calm you can get it, the better. Those of you that have ever been around Am, you know this is not something you do with a parade going on. Okay? This is not something you do with people shouting in front and shouting behind and throwing down stuff in front of them and throwing and coming behind and throwing. What would that do to a baby donkey? I mean, scared of death. I mean, that thing would be. And by the way, what do donkeys do when they get scared? Their reflex. What is it? You know? Like, yeah! Man, no ever walk behind a baby donkey. I mean, those of you, I just have to educate some of the city folk here. It's funny what city folk will do. They'll walk right behind a horse that's not been broken. I'm like, don't, get out back. What are you doing? They're like, what? You don't walk around the backside. One little, you know, and oh, you know what they do. They want to, you know, give it a little tap on the back hindquarter. What is that going to do? Man, reflex, whack. There you go. They go flying. Worst thing you can. And Jesus has got people throwing branches down behind him, in front of him, shouting, and it's not a small group. Why do I point out all these things? Because the guy we're talking about, he could heal the sick. We saw it in the first account. He raised the dead. He made the blind guy to see, calmed seas. Yeah, I did that one. And he calmed a donkey that no one had ever sat on. When you say, what's the big deal about this? I was on a farm, I know. This is crazy. But it's not, because it shows something that we need to recognize. He is the King of Kings. He's the master. When he comes into the circumstance, things that we would say, that you don't do that. You can't do that. When you're the master of the universe, can you ride a donkey that no one else has ever ridden? Will the donkey submit to you if you're the King of Kings? The Lord of Lords? Yes. These are some of the things that sometimes it goes right over city folks' head. They don't even recognize. This is a miracle. That he rode that donkey with all the noise, all the shouting. And he goes, now, you know, those of you that have seen baby donkeys, they're not that big. Some of you have even seen artistic portrayals where Jesus' feet are, you know, over the back of the donkey and they're almost touching the ground on each side because they're so small. But don't think for a minute that donkey couldn't kick you off as a grown man. They're strong little buggers. And they, just the fact that it let Jesus ride with, not just him, they threw their coats over the back of this donkey. And that donkey just said, okay. And took him right into Jerusalem, right up to the temple, right up to his appointment where he would tell them, get out. You guys that are making merchandise of the gospel, get out of here. This is not what it's about. This is my Father's house, and it's a house of what? Prayer. Palm Sunday should spur us to that place where we go to prayer. This should be a day where we celebrate the Lord came, but he reminded us what his Father's house was really about. His house, it says, was a prayer, a house of prayer for how many nations? All nations. That's what we should be praying for, is all the nations. Now it says here, verse 16 of John 12, let me just end with this. It says, these things his disciples did not understand at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written of him and that he had done these things. He's these guys, they did not get it. By the way, if you read your Bible, you don't get it at first, don't worry, you're in good company. The apostles, the A-team, they didn't get it, and they were there right there with Jesus. You know, some of you are too hard on yourselves. I read the Bible, Pastor. I didn't get the passage. I read it. I didn't understand it. I said, these guys were there living it. Did they get it? No. Even after he's gone, it says, it took a little while they remembered that he had done these things, that these things were written of him. Isn't it interesting how some of the things of the Spirit are just designed in such a way that we don't get what God's doing, even while he's doing it right in front of us? Anyone can give an amen to that? Where God has done something in your life, you did not even know what was going on. You didn't even see it coming. And he's going, I got it. And later you learn that he had that already figured out. Like, how much of this story do you think Jesus had figured out? Where the donkey is, right? I just want you to end with this. Pay attention. Did Jesus know where the donkey was? Did Jesus know that they were going to be stopped? Yeah, because he wouldn't have said, when they ask you, what are you doing, untying the donkey, you tell them this. The Lord has need of it. So he knew that they were going to be stopped. Did he know that the people are going to be making noise? Did he know that the religious guys, they weren't happy about him? But did that stop Jesus? No. He knows this whole circumstance. Now, his disciples don't understand it at this point. Like we don't sometimes. We don't understand what God's doing sometimes. We don't even get it. We're like, Lord, I don't know what you're doing. I'm lost here. Anyone ever felt like that in your Christian walk? Just me, right? Only the pastor. The rest of you are all good, golden. Look at you all. We have some days where we're just like, Lord, what are you doing? I don't know what you're doing. I don't get it. And the Lord goes, don't worry. You will. You will. This is the part I want to encourage you. Sometimes you don't understand the things that the Lord is doing at the time he's doing it. And you won't understand them till later. You know that saying, hindsight is, what is it, 20/20? We see stuff way better sometimes in retrospect than we do when we're going through it. But let me assure you, it's really important we pay attention to one key figure in this story, and that's Jesus. Because Jesus knew what was going on the whole time. He's the only one in the story who actually knew what was going down. And he's the one I want to steer you to today. I want to turn your attention heavenward to our risen Lord. Next week, we're going to celebrate the resurrection of the Lord. It's Easter. So we're going to look at some parts of the scripture celebrating him rising from the dead. But he knew even at this point, as he's riding in and they're crying, Hosanna, save now. He was going to save now. He was going to save from our sin. Don't worry. He'll come a second time on that stallion, that white flying horse we read in Revelation. He'll be back. And some guys are like, why do you think he's coming twice? Why don't you believe like the Jews, two different messiahs? No, it's the same messiah, just two different visits. That's the part they got wrong. Same guy, See, that's the part. It says a veil came over their eyes. They didn't understand. Even they don't get it sometimes. The religious leaders, did they understand who it was they were talking to? Tell your disciples to be quiet. If they knew he was truly the Son of God, you talk about religious leaders that are blind. By the way, do we have any religious leaders blind today? Can't see the Son of God for if he's standing in front of them? Sure. They don't get it. They have this, they claim to follow him. They claim to represent him, but they don't get it. They don't get it. We have them around. I don't want to be like that. I don't want to miss the Messiah when he shows up. I'm going to be going, oh, I'm telling him to be quiet. Jeepers, what kind of religious dudes are these guys? Are idiots. I mean, it's easy to say with hindsight, right? You're like, man, did you miss the big picture? But I love that. Well, I'll end here. John 12. So the people, verse 17 says, were with him. It says, when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead, they continued to testify about Jesus. And for this reason also, it says, people went out and met him because they heard that he had performed this sign. So the Pharisees said to one another, you see that you are not doing any good. Look, the whole world has gone after him. By the way, what's this do to their egos? These religious leaders, they are upset. Man, how dare you? We're losing our following. Everybody's going to follow Jesus. Yeah, praise the Lord. That's what I would like for. Wouldn't it be nice if at every church there was a big shift in focus to where all the people were, instead of following religious leaders, there you went and said, how was your fellowship today? Oh, man, everybody, we were exhorted to seek Jesus. He's the one that's the big name. He's the one where all the attention should go. He's the one that the very rocks would cry out if we would be quiet. But we've developed in Western Christianity personality cults. We got pastors that are like they act like they're more important than you come to hear me speak. This should never be that way. If I ever get like that, you guys just come take a pin, pop, you know, pop that balloon. That's ridiculous. We're supposed to be steering people to the Lord. They should look at us, and when they look, they go, what's that guy talking about? He always keeps pointing up. He's always, when I was a new Christian, you know what this meant? Not, I'm number one. It meant, he's one. One way. We used to go like this all the time. One way. There's one way to God. Put the attention to where it goes. The guy who is the way, the truth, the life, and no one comes to the Father except through him. Who is that guy? Jesus. This story makes me want everyone to go to Jesus, because Jesus knows everything that you need for whatever you're facing right now. You might have a circumstance where you're going, I don't know where the provision lies. I don't know how to make it through this. Jesus knew where the donkey was. He couldn't even see it. But he knew right where to send them, didn't he? And he knew right what to do when they said, what are you doing? Just, I'll tell you what to do. And this story, it just kind of bolsters my faith to go, I got to trust the Lord. What if he sends me to go do something? It seems insane. I asked how many of you would be one of the guys to go get the donkey. I can't get too many volunteers for this idea for some reason. How about, how many of you be the person willing to go get whatever it is he tells you to go get, because he has something for you he needs you to do? I hope that all of you would surrender and say, I'll do it. Whatever because, see, people tell me all the time, Pastor, you have all these miracles happen for you. You know, God does these wonderful things for you. And what they're not catching on to is, this isn't the first rodeo for me reading the stories. This isn't the first time I shared the Palm Sunday message. Since 1979, I had the privilege to teach about this. Every year. So like it's, you know, some people go, I've been to your church, but the pastor, he always preaches the same thing every time I'm there. Tells me you're once a year. You're supposed to be around all the time. You know, this isn't my only message, but this part is really juicy. And every time I go back to it, my faith is bolstered. It makes me think, man, Lord, whatever you say to do, let me be like one of the two guys. Maybe I'll be telling the other guy, you untie, and I'll tell him the word. But whatever, just give me the faith to walk after you and your instructions. Because the guys who got to do this, how do you think impacted their faith? From then on, you know, every time they thought, hey, the Lord says to go do this, or the Lord says we need that, or if you were one of those two fellas, I said, put yourself in their shoes. After you got the donkey, you're coming back. After you put the coat on the donkey, after Jesus gets on the donkey, after everyone's screaming, and the donkey is just doop-doop-doop-doop-doop-doop, taking him in, do you think your faith wouldn't grow? I mean, seriously, how much would your faith grow that day? He'd be like going, whoa. And by the way, did they know that baby donkeys don't give free rides on the first? Sure. I could just see him going, you put your coat. Waiting for the kick, you know, and nothing happens. And Jesus just gets on. Something must have been in their processor going, whoa, this guy we're with. I mean, he makes the bread, you know, the fish. Remember the loaves and the fish? Here, everyone sit down. 5,000 men. They didn't count the women and the children. 5,000 men is a big miracle in itself. Because it says they ate till they were glutted. All from a lad's lunch. Here. Father, thank you. Break it. Hand it to. And I always. Now, see, I've asked some of you. Who would be one of the bread passer outers? Is that a right term? You know, like if I said, Jesus is asking a couple of you to help out, you know, and he breaks the bread, hands it to you, and you take that loaf and you start breaking it and handing it. Who would do that? Who? I would, man. That would be so cool. I mean, you'd, like it just keeps, you tear off a piece, here you go. You look down, tear off another piece, look down. Man, you talk about, what would it do for your faith that day? If you don't think God is real, I mean, those guys, and these guys said, we have seen these things. We have held with our hands. We have behold this one concerning the word of life. This is the guy we're telling you about. Interesting to me, these guys, they saw Jesus provide. They saw Jesus be master over a universe that, in their understanding, this doesn't work. But when you're the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords, you can do anything. And we need a little encouragement in that. That he's in charge. That he can do anything. And all we got to do is follow him. He knows where the provision lies. Don't worry. I know we don't. I know some of you know. I'm certain you don't know because you call me. Pastor, I don't know where the provision lies. And you know what my job is, right? Turn your eyes upon who? Jesus. By the way, that was Chuck Smith's favorite hymn, he said. Look full in his wonderful face. And what's going to happen to the things of earth will grow strangely dim. In what? In the light of his glory and grace. Let's end with that. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for this wonderful account, Lord, that all four of these gospel writers telling us little details of this day. That your son rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. Lord, may these details just be quickened by your spirit in our spirits, Lord, today. That these little things would bring them to our remembrance when we need them. That we would know your power, Lord, power over situations and circumstances that we're fearful of, Lord. Things we don't understand, but you do, and that you know where the provision lies, Lord. Comfort us with that knowledge as we go from here, Lord. And we do want to make this place a house of prayer for all nations. Lord, we pray for all the missionaries that we support. We ask that your Holy Ghost just gives them this day what they need. For Mary in Thailand and Ron Miller there with the orphanages. With our brother Edgar and Larissa over in Moscow. We pray for them, the ones that took over for Kevin Mackin. Lord, help Kevin this day. We pray for all of those that with YWAM, our brother Joe that went off on the missions group with the Korean contingent, Lord. Watch over them, Lord, in the places that they're going right now, sharing your gospel. We ask your hand of protection be on them. Be with us now, Lord. Give us what we need from your Spirit as we go from here. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen. Would you guys stand with me listening?
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.